God. Amongst edification, we got to chop it up a little bit, do a little this, do a little that. I mean, that's good, man. It's good to see God's people out here hungry for the word. That's what it's all about. I'm not even, let's go into Matthew 5. I was gonna go to Romans 6, Romans 2, but it's alright. Spirit lead me to Matthew.
You're gonna go from the top? Here.
Huh?
From the top?
From the top. Everything in context.
This is the book of Matthew, chapter 5, verse 1. And seeing the multitude, he went up into the mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for there is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God.
So, as we see, those who are downtrodden, misled, misguided, misunderstood, mistaught, all the disses and misses you can throw in there, all those people shall be redeemed. All those people shall be saved. They shall be put on high once more. As I say, as blessed are those who are, we're going to get later into the chapter, blessed are those who are peacemakers. We're going to be the peacemakers. We're going to be the loving ones, ones who are shed the light. That is our job amongst the nations. It's going to tell you later in the chapter, it's not good for somebody to take a light and hide it under a bushel or hide it under a bed. What's the point of a light? All these lights are not hid. They're to illuminate and show you the way. Hey, this is where you get burdens. This is where you get this. This is where you get that. This is where you get salvation and life. Finish.
Verse 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God.
The peacemakers are called the children of God. You shall be known by your fruits. That is very imperative that we take heed to what's going being said here. The children or the peacemakers shall be called the children of God. So you can't go up to people with contention all the time, trying to pick a fight all the time, trying to argue all the time, and call yourself a child of God. It's off. Christ's red letter is telling you right now, you're not in his spirit. Leave.
Verse 10, blessed are they which persecuted for righteousness' sake.
For righteousness' sake. Not persecuted because you wouldn't listen to the officer when he told you to pack up your stuff and leave. That's not for righteousness' sake, because you know there's an ordinance, you know there's this, you know there's that. What does Christ also say? Agree with thy adversary quickly. So let's not get obstinate and hard-headed when it comes to certain things. We have to keep all scripture in mind at all times. Read.
God, it says, blessed are they which persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manners of evil against you falsely, for my sake,
for his sake. Not because somebody offended your doctrine. Not because somebody talked about your camp leader. Not because somebody hurt your feelings in a chat room. When somebody offends you for the name of Christ alone, then you are blessed, and then it will be counted to you. Go ahead.
Verse 12. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets.
They also persecuted the prophets. Now, does that make you a prophet? No! And you just said you're going to suffer persecution like the prophets. Go ahead.
Verse 13. Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its savior, wherewith shall it be salted? It is therefore good for nothing.
Slug it. Now, salt is good for adding flavor. Adding that little kick, that pizzazz to things that are otherwise bland. What is salt also used for? As a preservation. Did you know, there's a quick fact about salt. Ancient civilizations used to pack their meat in salt and put it in the ground to preserve it because they didn't have refrigerators. So salt, when it says you are the salt of the earth, we're also the preservers of life. So that's a double entendre when you get into that, okay?
It says, ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its savor,
it also heals.
Wherewith shall it be salted? It is therefore still for nothing, but and to be trodden underfoot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on an hill cannot be hid.
And Jerusalem was literally set on a hilltop.
Go ahead.
It says we are the light of the world. What is the light supposed to do? Shine. Give illumination. Make the way visible. What is the way? The way of Christ.
Go ahead.
Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bristle, but on a candlestick, and it giving light unto all that are in the house.
There it is. All that are in the house. That is very key, because not everyone is going to be in the house of Christ. Not everyone is going to be counted as a child of God. Not everyone is going to be able to cling and partake to the same thing that the Israelites are able to cling and partake to. Go ahead.
Verse 16, let your light so shine before men.
Before men.
That they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven.
Not you, not your camp leader, not your breakdowns. Glorify the Father. Go ahead.
Speak not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
But to fulfill. Now hold that right there. I want to get a precept. We need to get some understanding on that. Yeah, let me get Romans 15 and 19. We need to understand what Christ said when he said it. He did not come to destroy the law, but to fulfill. Because people explain that all the time, but never give any backup as to why their breakdown or their understanding on that particular scripture is what it is.
It's the book of Romans, chapter 15, verse 19. Through mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about unto I have fully preached the gospel of Christ.
What did Paul do?
Fully preached the gospel of Christ.
He fully preached the gospel of Christ. So that's what it means to fulfill. When you look into the Greek, you'll see that word for fully preached and the word for fulfill in Matthew 17 and 18 is the same word. So when Christ is breaking this down, read that again, Matthew 5 and 17.
Matthew 5 and 17, think not that I am come to destroy the law.
Not to destroy the law.
Or the prophets.
Or what the prophets wrote.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
But to fully teach the full, proper understanding of the scriptures, of the prophecy, of the things that were written of Christ. Because there's a lot of correction going on with Christ at the scene.
Verse 18, for verily I say unto you, the heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
So until everything's actually fulfilled, that means the second coming of Christ. That means the nation's coming to us to get the wisdom, knowledge, and understanding and the ordinance of the Most High. Everything in Revelation, all that has to come true before the law even begins to be thought of as done away with. That hasn't happened, so therefore the law's still intact. Read.
Verse 19. Whosoever therefore shall break one of the least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven.
Now, if you're breaking the commandments and teaching men to do so, your Creflo Dollars, your T.D. Jakes, Joyce Mayer, all of them, if they're teaching that the law's done away with, when Christ out of his own mouth just said the law's not done away with, that lets you know what spirit they're coming in. Go ahead.
But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven.
So if you teach them to break the laws, you're going to be called the least of heaven. It doesn't say you're not going to make it. It says you'll be called the least in heaven. So that means you're going to make it, but you're jeopardizing your role in the kingdom. Go ahead.
Verse 20. For I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees.
So it's not just about keeping the law. It's not just about keeping the law, because the scribes and Pharisees kept the law. So it says, unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees. What?
He shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven.
You have no chance of entering. You have to be more righteous than they were, because they kept the law, but they were evil in their hearts. Read.
Verse 21. Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time.
Who said this in old times? The prophets and those who taught the Mosaic law. Read.
Thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment.
It says that in Torah. Thou shalt not murder. Plainly. And if you murder, then you're in judgment of murder. Boom. Point blank. Period. But what does Christ do here? There's something that Christ does. People love to teach that Christ never changed the law. But he did. He elevated the law from a physical standpoint to a spiritual standpoint. There's no denying that unless you want to throw out this scripture. Read.
But I say unto you.
What?
But I say unto you.
So he's saying something different than what the law says.
Yeah.
Read.
Now, whosoever is angry with his brother.
So now if you're angry with your brother, not if you literally kill him, if you hate him in your heart. Read.
That whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Rabbah, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire.
So there it is right there. It's letting you know it's very specific. Christ knew they were going to try to catch him up in his words. So he's very careful with his word selection. Read.
Verse 23. Therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there remember God that thy brother have aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar and go thy way.
So you might, if you're trying to make a peace offering to the Most High and you haven't made things right with your brother, you might as well leave your peace offering where it's at, go home, fix things with your brother, and then go do that peace offering. Because until you do, the Most High is not dealing with it. You can't ask for forgiveness from the Most High and then still hate your brother in his heart. Go ahead.
It says, leave therefore thy gift before the altar and go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift.
Reconcile first. It's not the first time Christ is going to use this. When we get into the divorce, Christ is going to tell us he wants reconciliation first. Go ahead.
Verse 25. Agree with thy adversary quickly while thou art in the way with him, that at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge, and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and thou be carried in the prison.
So you want to get mad with the police, you want to get mad with the authority figure, and whatever situation, stick your chest all out because you feel you in the right. Well, all you got to do is agree, yes sir, yes, I was wrong. It'll get worked out. If you was right, they're going to figure it out. They're going to go back, look at the cameras, they're going to do whatever they got. The Most High going to make sure you're straight. Christ is telling you, do what's in your best interest. Because if you don't do what's in your best interest, he has the power to jack you up. And there's nothing you can do about it. Why? Because you're in his kingdom. Read.
Verse 26. Verily I say unto thee, thou shalt by no means come out then, till thou hast paid the uttermost farthing. Verse 27. Ye have heard that it was said.
Here it goes again.
By them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her, have committed adultery with her already in his heart.
Now, is Christ saying if you look at a woman, you're sinning? No. He says if you look after a woman to lust after her. Now you start fantasizing in your mind what you're going to do to this woman. Oh, I would do this. And, oh, ooh, and this is what I would. All of that, that's lusting. Your yes is already, like I tell brothers all the time, your yes is already on the table. If she walked over to you and she said, hey, what's up? You trying to get down? Your yes is already on the table. In your heart, you are, oh, yeah, she gave me one chance. That's all I need is one shot. That's the day, right? I'm trying to shoot my shot. I just need one. That's it. Your yes is already on the table. And that's it. You eager to please like that? The next thing you know, it be the same Jake that end up in the situation of Deuteronomy 28:54. Hating their baby mamas, leaving their kids, and stuff like that. Why? Because you didn't take the proper steps. This is the teaching here. That when you take the proper steps and you court a woman and you get to know her on a friendship level, on a spiritual level, and then y'all end up becoming mates, you avoid a lot of issues that our generation that are running into. And read that again from that verse from the top.
Matthew 5:8. But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her.
And this is the spirit of our brothers when they go out. Oh, let's get the shorty with the fattest cakes. Let's get the shorty with the biggest bosom. Let's get the shorty showing the most flesh. The most raunchiest, nastiest. I don't want a wifer though. This is the spirit of our men. This is the spirit of our men that are out here leading these children and these other women. And what leads to that? Lust, fornication, and divorce out of that. You're just, oh, well, we didn't really tie the knot, and we didn't really whoop-de-whoop-de-whoop, and we didn't do it, so I don't really have any obligations. You're causing her to be an adulteress and a fornicator, and yourself as well. Read.
But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her has committed adultery with her already.
Already? You already guilty. You don't have to actually do the deed. Why do you think women get mad when they find you texting another woman? Your yes is already on the table. Had this chick came over here and things would have been just right, you would have cheated on me. Christ is saying your heart is in the wrong place. Christ is saying the same thing. We can't be simple. Read.
Verse 29. And if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee.
If you can't stay off these social media apps without texting other females, delete them. They're ruining your marriage, your relationship, your image of your son to his father. You're ruining your home because you can't be, oh, well, it says we can, okay. Those men who are able to have multiple wives know who they are. They're able to provide on a level that most of us are not. Let them be them. This is not you. This is what you need to stick to, what Christ said. Stop trying to be other people. Stay in your lane. Go ahead.
And if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. For it is possible for thee that one of thy members shall perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell.
Hold on. Now, that's twofold. That's twofold. If anything is keeping you from serving Christ in the Most High, cut it off. Get rid of it. It's dead to you. You're better off being a paraplegic or quadriplegic, spiritually speaking, than be out here running around with the enemy in sin and fornication, doing all manner that are against the Bible. You see what I'm saying? Now, if there's a member of the congregation / body that does not want to adhere to what Christ's words are, you have to cut them off because they're a hindrance to you. This is read that from the top again, please.
Matthew 5:29. And if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee.
This is twofold, man. This is twofold.
For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish.
It's profitable that one of those members be excommunicated, cut off, suspended, whatever the case may be, then what?
If not, let thy whole body be cast into hell.
What do they do with cancer? They find the source of the cancer, they find the cancer, and they cut it out. Why? Because that cancer will spread and infect the rest of that area and eventually the whole body. So it's better to cut off that area, that member, that section, whatever it is, than the whole body to perish. Because that virus, that illness, that sin is going to spread and dilute and pollute the rest of the congregation. Read.
Verse 30. And if thy right hand offend thee, cut it off and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body.
Same thing. I don't have to go back over that. Same thing. Go ahead.
Verse 31. It has been said, whosoever shall put away his wife, they have given her a writing of divorce.
So when it comes to divorce, all you have to do, no matter what, is just write a bill of divorce. You know what? You looking fat this week. I'm done. Here you go. It's over with. What did Christ say? Now, how do you cause her to be an adulterous woman? by, you know what? I'm not feeling you, you're not feeling me, we're gonna take a break. And while we're taking a break, we're both out here smashing other people. Both, when y'all come back together, you are both, I don't care if you both agree to the break, you are both adulterers. Why? Because there was not a proper divorce put in place. This is what Christ is saying. Go ahead. So no hall pass. No hall pass. That's against Christ. Go ahead.
Verse 33. Again, we have heard that it has been said by them of old time, thou shalt not forswear thyself, but shalt perform unto the Lord thy oath.
Don't swear. Man, I'm going to give you that money tomorrow. I swear to God. Oh, my mama, I'm serious, cuz. Whatever. Hey, bro, I promise. Hey, bro, you know what I'm doing? Whatever it is, don't do that. Why? Because we don't have the power to make anything happen. We wake up and go on and about our day. The Most High holds all the power. He's the only one that can make promises. He's the one that makes the sun go up and go down. He makes the rain fall on the just and the unjust alike. We don't have that power. So we damn sure don't have the power to go around making promises to people. Because when they don't go through, then we look like an idiot. When we can abstain from all that and just be like, you know what? Lord willing, I'm gonna do my best. You know what? Hey, I can accept that. Because if it don't happen, hey, something must have came up. You see what I'm saying? Then it's not like, hey, I promise. Well, he swore. He gave me his word. What did they say? Your word is your bond, right?
Right. This is James chapter 4, verse 14. Let me start at 13. Go to now, ye that say today, for tomorrow we will go into such a city and continue there and give and buy and sell and get paid.
You're making a lot of definite statements. I'm gonna go to Miami. I'm gonna stay in this restaurant. I'm gonna eat at this restaurant. Stay at this hotel. I'm gonna buy this. I'm gonna go to this club. You making all these promises and you can die on the way. You can die on the way and then what? All them plans you set up, yeah, they still took your money out your account. You see what I'm saying? Them reservations still, hey.
I gotta get paid.
Right, yeah, come on, man, go ahead.
Verse 14. Whereas ye have known not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. For that ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that.
Always say Lord willing, because it's up to him ultimately. It's all his plan. We just, what do you call it, the Sims? We just characters in sin. Most High running all of this.
Matthew 5, verse 34. But I say unto you, you are not at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne. Verse 35. Nor by the earth, for it is his footstool, neither by Jerusalem.
So don't swear by great things or small. No matter, don't swear, oh, I swear to God, or I'll put that on my mama's grave. Whether it's heavenly or earthly, it don't matter. Don't swear on it.
But it is nor by the earth, for it is the wisdom neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Neither shalt thou swear by thy head, because thou canst not make one hair white or black.
That's saying, oh, that's my word. Oh, you got my promise on that. You can't guarantee anything. Like I said, you can't make one hair white or black. So who are you to promise anything? Go ahead.
Verse 37. But let your communication be day, 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 night. For whatsoever is more than these cometh of evil.
So just do what you say you're going to do. If you're going to do something, follow through and say, Lord willing, and do it. Then everyone would know. You don't have to tell it. Oh, I'm a man of my word. I'll keep my promise. Everyone will know. Your works will speak for themselves.
Verse 38. We have heard that it has been said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, that ye resist not evil. But whoso...
He said, wait, what? I say what?
He said, but I say unto you, that ye resist not evil.
Resist not evil. Wait a second. Now what's going on here? What is Christ teaching now? We're supposed to hang out with evil people? Who did Christ hang out with?
He hang out with the
The sinners and the publicans, the harlots, the tax collectors. He hung out with the worst of the worst, and he let his light shine, as we read earlier in Matthew. So Christ is living out the same thing that he's preaching. He's not just telling you something that sounds good. There's other accounts that you can find where they ask him, why is he hanging out with these people? Doesn't he know who they are? He claims to be this person. Doesn't he know? Yes, he does, but these are the people that need the help. So you don't resist evil. You be the light amongst it. You don't give into it. You know what I mean? You be in the world, don't be of the world. Go ahead.
But I say unto you that ye resist thy evil. But whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if any man will sue thee at the law and take away thy cloak, let him have thy cloak also.
Second, right there. Now, why would a man sue you? Because you ripped him off, done something wrong. There's some shortcoming somewhere of why he is suing you. So when it says if someone slaps you on your right cheek, give him the left cheek, it's in the manner of if you've done them wrong and they get back on you, you can't get mad after that because now they're getting even. The scales are being balanced, so to speak. So that's what if a man sues you for your shirt because you're in the wrong, you should give him your jacket as well. Go ahead.
Verse 41. Whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. Give to him that asks of thee, and from him that will borrow of thee.
Burn like it. Don't take Jake to the bus stop. Take him home. That's what it, don't be a half-assed good citizen. Don't be a half-assed brother. Don't be a half-assed lover, bro. That's what it's saying. Oh, yeah, I got you a ride, bro. I'm going to drop you off at the bus stop. No, take me home, bro. Because what if the bus that comes is out of service? Now I got to wait out here another 2 hours, depending on how long. You see what I'm saying? And now I don't want to bother you because you already said, he obviously didn't want to take me home because he dropped me off at the bus stop. You see what I'm saying? Now you put the brother in a position, you see what I'm saying, where he feels like he's bothering you for asking something that no brother should even have to ask. To be honest, go ahead.
Verse 42. Give to him that asketh of thee, and from him that will borrow of thee, turn not thou away.
Turn not thou away. If you got it, give it. Because the Most High had it and he gave it to you. The Most High had Christ and he gave him to us. So who are we to be stingy with anything when it comes to material things, knowledge, wisdom, understanding? We are to give and be the light. Go ahead.
Verse 43. Ye have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy.
But I got precepts showing how we can hate Esau.
Ye have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy.
But the Bible says Esau going into slavery, y'all.
Ye have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy. But I say unto you,
what did Christ say?
Love your enemy. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you.
Now, all those things happen to us by the hands of the so-called white men and the other nations listed in Psalms 83 and 3. Well, how does that change how we're supposed to act? Their judgment, what they have coming to them, doesn't change how we're supposed to act and be the light towards other people. We're supposed to be the wisdom to the other nations. We're supposed to teach them how to act and behave. Because as I said earlier, when you look around the world, obviously they don't know how to behave. They can't follow the ways of the ways of the Hamashiach Yahawashah. Go ahead.
But I say unto you, love your enemy. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. Pray for them which despitefully use and persecute you, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh his sun rise on the evil and on the good.
Well, okay, when it says love your enemy, that's talking about Israel, though. See, and I got precepts that said your neighbor is of your own people. See, I got precepts, like you can't get me on that. That's talking about Israel.
Let's see what Christ says. It says, and send it right on the just and on the unjust. For if ye love him which love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans the same? And if ye salute your brethren only, what do ye more than others? public is so, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect.
There you have it right there.
That's how you be perfect.
There
Christ,
it is.
Christ literally showed you how to be perfect.
Matthew 1, Matthew 5 and 1, all the way down to that last verse, is how you be perfect. Let your light shine amongst men. It says, in spite of all these things that have happened, you're supposed to love and be a light to all those nations, because they're going to come to us with the wisdom, knowledge, and understanding anywhere. We have to teach them how to behave. If not, then we're not doing what Christ commanded us to do. We're not actually being the watchmen that is talked about in Ezekiel. We're not being the bearers of the light. We're not being Christ-like in a nutshell. And it says after 6 or 7, after Christ, because he goes into 2 more chapters, I'm going to wrap it up here. But it says after Christ got done speaking these things, it says that they were amazed at his doctrine. Why were they amazed at Christ's doctrine? Because it was so vastly different from the doctrine of the Pharisees and the old teachers of the way. That's why he says over and over again, I know it is said of old, or they say in old times, or it is written, but I say, Christ has elevated the law from a physical standpoint to a spiritual standpoint. And with that, I say shalom.
I
want to turn
this because you said it was astonishing. This is Matthew 7 in verse 28.
There it is.
And it came to pass when Yahushua ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority and not as a scribe. So that's why they were amazed at the doctrine, because we could clearly see in Matthew 5, he's not teaching as a scribe, but he's teaching as the one in authority. He says, I know it was said by them from old time. But I say, so he's teaching in the one of an authority. And with that, I would say, Shalom.